I found the population of two villages living destitute in the rubble of this shoe factory in Kabul. They'd fled attacks by warlords who'd robbed them and kidnapped their wives and daughters.
I've spent much of my life in places of upheaval, but I've rarely seen such a bombed and blasted and ruined city as Kabul. Most of the damage was done not by the Taliban, but by the Afghan warlords backed and trained and funded by America for more than 20 years, the same warlords who have been effectively put back into power by George Bush.
While Afghanistan's liberation from the Taliban was welcomed here and brought certain freedoms, such as the opening of schools and the playing of music, for many people, another kind of terror replaced it, one barely acknowledged in the West. And not only has the government in Kabul no power and no money, the president, Hamid Karzai, dares not leave his office without his 42 bodyguards from the US Special Forces. Real power is held by these men, warlords, whose record of repression and brutality is little different from the Taliban. The warlords are terrorists, bribed by the Americans with a fortune in cash and truckloads of arms. Today, they control the government in Kabul and have re-established the opium trade, from which comes most of the heroin reaching the streets of Britain. Now, Human Rights Watch has broken the silence, documenting atrocities committed by gunmen and warlords who have essentially hijacked the country. To a growing number of people around the world, America's war on terror is about hypocrisy and double standards, about terrorists classified as good and bad, depending on their usefulness to the great game of power politics. For years, Osama bin Laden was not only regarded in Washington and London as a good terrorist, he was virtually our creation. One of the most closely guarded secrets of the Cold War was America's role in supporting Afghan warlords known as the Mujahideen. The official story is that America backed these fundamentalists in response to the Soviet invasion of Afghanistan in December 1979. But that's not true. It was 6 months before the Soviet invasion, in July of that year, that President Jimmy Carter authorized $500 million to help set up the Mujahideen, a terrorist organization. The American people were completely unaware that their government, together with the British Secret Service, MI6, had begun training and funding Islamic extremists, including Osama bin Laden. Out of this came the Taliban, Al-Qaeda, and September the 11th. Soon after the Taliban came to power in 1996, the administration of Bill Clinton backed a secret plan for a pipeline through Afghanistan from Central Asia, which has vast reserves of oil and gas. The Taliban were offered a generous cut in the deal and secretly invited to Washington and Texas. They were treated royally, taken shopping and flown to tourist attractions like the NASA Space Center and Mount Rushmore. Their tour was so secret that no television news covered it. Most Americans knew nothing. By the time George W. Bush came to power, the link between Al-Qaeda and the Taliban was an embarrassment, and September the 11th gave Bush an opportunity to get rid of them. Today, Afghanistan is run by a regime installed by the Americans, and the pipeline deal is going ahead.